right, well, let's jump right into it today. Had a great weekend. I hope you did as well. I actually had a chance to speak with, I met a brother who found my content on YouTube like a year or so ago, something like that. And he actually moved to the town that I'm living in right now. This is his hometown, and he moved back to his hometown. And we had a chance to have lunch and all that kind of stuff. It was really, really good. But we had a conversation that I wanted to talk a little bit about today. And we were talking about sort of the strategic conversation that a lot of people are having right now about where they should live and where they should move to and where they should put down roots and all that kind of stuff. And it got me thinking about a gab that I saw from Michael Foster. I re-gabbed this. Re-gabbed? Repost? I don't know what it's called. I think it's called repost. But I re-gabbed this, and here's what it said. It said, over the last year, I've considered moving my family to a safer and freer geographic location. For example, Montana, Alaska, Idaho, something like that. He says, I decided against it. We're putting down roots in Ohio. Why? Because at some point, you have to stand your ground and you have to fight back. There's no outrunning this battle. Find a community, build it up, and have each other's back. This is really good advice, and I re-gabbed this and I said, I'm planning on staying in New Hampshire and I have no plans to leave. And he's right. I mean, there's no outrunning this fight. You can apply this to where you live. You can apply this to where you're going to church. I've heard so many unbelievable stories. Like, it's just madness out there right now, guys. It's complete madness. I heard a story, I've heard so many stories about woke church infiltrating and these mask mandates and just various things, like just so many stories of people that are being, you know, pushed out of their church because of just madness regarding COVID, regarding woke church, regarding all this kind of stuff. And we all have different things that we need to consider, strategically speaking, to decide whether we stay and fight or whether we go and we find another church to go to or another place to live or something like that. And what you have to do is consider strategically what makes the most sense for you and your family. You should be thinking about winning, because here's the reality. Christ is king over the South. Christ is king over Texas. Christ is king over Montana, Idaho, Alaska. But he's also king over Ohio. He's also king over New Hampshire, New York, Maine, California. He's king everywhere. So he has crown rights to everything. It's all his. But it might be advantageous to leave California for a time. It might be advantageous to fight this fight somewhere else. I think New Hampshire has a lot going for it. New Hampshire is, I think, very fertile ground. It's a small place, relatively speaking. My town is a small town, relatively speaking. It's got a liberal center to it, and it's because we have a college in my town. But basically, everyone around the town is very conservative. And so I think, strategically speaking, to attempt to capture the town that I live in for Christ is something that strategically, not only would it be advantageous, but it also could actually happen. Like, it's attainable. And so you have to decide where you fight. Do you remember the movie 300, where they knew they were going to fight? The Spartans knew they were going to have to fight the Persians. There was no running away. The Persians were coming for them. So what they decided to do was go out to them and meet them at that narrow pass where they felt like they had the best chance to take as many Persians with them as they possibly could. So what they did was they said, okay, the fight is coming. Let me select carefully where to fight. If I can't help it, if the fight is coming no matter where I go, let me take an advantage and say, okay, I can't decide whether or not to fight you. It's going to happen. But I can decide where to fight you. And they fought him at that narrow pass, and they took a lot of them out with them and all that kind of stuff. It was a strategically advantageous place for them. And so that's the decision you have to make. You have to decide what is strategically advantageous to you. Like, what is, you got to decide what your goals are. You have to, because you can't decide whether or not to fight these guys. Like, the pagans are coming for you. There's no question about it. They cannot stand that anyone exists that does not acknowledge their gods. That's not the kind of religion that they have. They cannot stand that you, like, it's not enough for you to just leave them alone. Like, that's the thing. I think a lot of conservatives were very naive to think, well, you know, we'll just leave the homosexuals alone and they'll be fine. It's not like that with them. Not only do you have to not, you know, say they can't get married, but you have to affirm it. You have to celebrate it. You have to be all about it. Like, it's not enough. They won't be left alone. They'll come for you, and they want you to celebrate their perversion. And so that's just an example. Of course, there's many other ways where this plays itself out. So there's no running away from this fight. It's going to happen. So you need to decide where to fight the fight. That's as simple as that. And this applies to churches as well. I've got someone in my life that is, you know, and they're in a church where they're not so sure about the future of the denomination. Lots of you are in this exact position. You're in the SBC, you're in the PCA, you're like, there's a very strong chance that there's going to be division, there's going to be a church split, the liberals are going to take over. And so people are right now full of decision-making opportunities. Do I stay in my church and fight? Do I stay and I fight the mask mandate? Or do I go find a better church that is not going to require me to wear a piece of clothing over my face to cover my face in order to worship God, like as if I'm in Saudi Arabia? Man, I saw a commercial last night where it was like, we were watching, I forget what show we were watching. It wasn't the Super Bowl. But there was a lot of advertisements for masks. And it was like, all these like models, like attractive models with their face covered. I mean, it's like, what were we, in Saudi Arabia? Like, where are we? Anyway, side issue. So you have to decide whether or not it's worth it to stay and fight or to leave and fight another day. Like, that's the thing. The fight is coming. I was talking to one brother, and he was considering another denomination, a more conservative denomination, and instead of the one he's at currently. And I told him, like, okay, like, that's fine. You can definitely consider moving, go into a more conservative denomination, but it depends on where you're at in life right now, what your goals are, because the reality is the woke church and the COVID cult is coming for that denomination too. I've already seen rumblings of it in that denomination. It's a great denomination. It's a great denomination. But there's already rumblings of the egalitarian stuff going on in there and stuff like that. So you need to understand, like retreating to another denomination, a better denomination, will delay when you fight, maybe, but it's not going to delay if you fight. You're going to fight the battle. The liberals cannot leave well enough alone. The pagans want it all. The pagans are post-millennial. The pagans think that their religion is going to dominate everything. They believe it. They're sold out to it, and they're going after it. And so it doesn't matter. They think it all belongs to Satan. So they're going to go, and they're gonna fight this fight anywhere they have to. There's no, you cannot run away from this. And so I told him, I said, are you ready to fight now? Because if you're ready to fight now, you might want to consider staying where you're at and staying in the front lines. But if you're not ready to fight now, perhaps it's okay to go to a more conservative denomination for a season and get prepared, because it's going to come there. You're not going to outrun this thing. And that's the reality. Like, we all have to make those decisions. Are we ready to fight now? Because if we are, then this might be the time to do it. If you're not, I can understand retreat. I can understand a strategic, you know, falling back kind of thing. But you're never going to outrun this fight. You're never going to be able to not fight the fight. The fight is there. And the reality is that God put us in this position, in this time, in this location, because he expects a return from putting us here. He expects us to do good works, because he prepared those good works beforehand for us to walk in them. And so the fight is in front of us, and we need to decide where we fight, like Leonidas in 300. We can't outrun the Persians. The Persians are coming. They want it all. They think their king, their emperor, is God. And so they're going to come for you. You can decide where to fight them. You can decide to go out and meet them. You can decide to wait for them to come. You can decide to maybe retreat or fall back or something like that. There's a lot of decisions that you can make, but you cannot decide if to fight. If you're a Christian, you're gonna fight. It's just that simple. It's just that simple. I was making fun of the other day. Eric Mason was saying how, like, the non-woke people act like they can throw them hands. You know, like, he was trying to say, like, he could beat them up and stuff. And I was joking. I was like, listen, Eric, I don't want to fight you, but if you came for me, I would fight you. You'd have to catch me first. I don't think you can catch me, Eric, because you'd be huffing and puffing all day. But the reality is, I don't want to fight you, but if it happens, it happens. That's the thing. You just have to deal with it that way. I heard this insane story. Man, brothers, if you're in a situation like this, you need to know that you're not alone. I've talked to probably maybe 10 people in the last couple of weeks about this mask madness, this mask madness at church where people, pastors think they have the authority to force their congregations into covering their faces for worship. Like, it's absolute madness. But I heard, this is the craziest story that I've heard so far. I've heard a lot of crazy stories about what's being required by pastors. How they think they have the authority to do these things is so beyond me. It's just complete madness. But this is the worst one I've heard yet. Let me just read it to you. So this person has been the only family. They've been the only family to not wear a mask throughout this pandemic. And there's been a lot of pressure put on them to wear the mask. You're not loving your neighbor. You hate grandma. You know, all the usual stuff, right? So I don't know how big the church is, but literally every other person in the church wears a mask, and this person and her family doesn't wear the mask. Listen to this insanity. This is madness, guys. She says this: "Today the church made a public announcement that we are all required to wear masks at all times unless we are actively eating or drinking at church. This is interesting because every single person in the room is already wearing a mask except for one family, mine. Instead of coming to us directly and talking to us, asking our stance and getting our side of the story, they chose to publicly humiliate us in front of the entire church. Thankfully, my husband was there. He normally works on Sunday mornings, and we've started a home church on Sunday nights, and we just got up and left. What's going on here? I can't go back now. How could they do this when the science doesn't even support this? This isn't loving. Also, they don't know this because nobody bothered to ask me, but I've been bedridden for the past 3 weeks with a terrible migraine, so wearing a mask isn't even a possibility for me anyway. So the one time I get out of bed and make it to church, they publicly decide to make an example of me and my family. I don't even know what to do anymore." This is madness. There's like layers of effeminacy in this thing. Like it's it's not even effeminacy. It's just wickedness. It's not effeminacy. It's wickedness. Instead of doing the biblical thing, because let's just imagine that you're so twisted up as a pastor, your mind is so perverted as a pastor that you're like, okay, it's actually loving your neighbor to wear the mask. Like, it's actually a law of God. You have to wear the mask according to the law of God. It says so in Deuteronomy. Let's just say that you were so twisted up, you thought there was a law in Deuteronomy that said you have to wear a mask during the COVID-19 pandemic. Instead of doing the biblical thing and going to this family and saying, "Brother, sister, you guys are in sin. You're not following Deuteronomy. Wear the mask. And I want to plead with you privately to wear the mask and do the right thing according to Deuteronomy chapter mask wearing COVID." Instead of doing that, you go straight to the public humiliation. You go straight to the public. What's it called? Not even humiliation. It's rejection. It's the shunning. It's church discipline in a public way. There's just layers of disobedience here. Like, the pastors are making up law, they're making up a moral code, they're making up elements of worship, and then on top of that, they're doing it the completely upside down way of a public just dissociation with the family, the unpersons over there, that family who we've never even talked to them, because we don't even know if they can wear the mask or not, or what their reasons are, or anything like that. They just go straight to the church discipline. Listen, guys, this is madness. This is madness. I'm not gonna make a blanket statement like that. But if what this person messaged me resembles your church in any way, I would suggest that this might be the time to fight it publicly. Fight it according to scripture. Privately, bring some elders, bring some people. Fight it or leave. This can't be how church is done. This is absolute madness. The pastor doesn't get to just make stuff up as he goes along. This is just it's insanity. This might be the time to fight. If this resembles your church, this might be the time to fight. Or it might be the time to retreat. Or it might be the time for a strategic, you know, falling back or whatever it is. But you can't just let this stuff go by, especially if you're a man. You can't just let your pastor pretend like he's got all these authorities that he doesn't have. Refuse consent. Refuse consent to this madness, because this doesn't stop anywhere good. Anyway, got a little heated there. I'm going to end this video right there. I hope you found it helpful. God bless.